Okay, let's start. First, who am I? I am a senior front-end developer from a company called KMP Labs France. And basically, what I'm doing there, I'm evangelizing BDD across the world. Also, I'm the creator of open source frameworks for BDD called BHAT and Bing. It's HP frameworks mostly, but don't worry, today I will talk about things applicable to another frameworks and other languages, and that's it. So basically, yeah, here's the links. Most important link is card.rz.com. You can find any social network that I'm assigned to on this page. So let's start. Basically, the biggest question of this topic is, what's our primary job nowadays as developers or development companies? And I would say that our biggest job and main job is to make our clients happy. If you think that our main job is to build awesome products or really great technically developed software stacks, you're wrong, because clients don't go to us with the idea of technical stacks or awesome products. What they need is happiness, and this happiness is a product they want. But currently, this is the state of our market. And on market, we have more awesome languages, more awesome frameworks, and as a consequence, we have more awesome developers. So the question is it client happiness? I would say no, it isn't. Because really, if we take a little bit deeper, client happiness is valuable product. And awesome languages or awesome frameworks or even awesome developers doesn't really mean valuable product. In reality, awesome is not really close to the term valuable, because, for example, I suppose everybody knows about Google Wave, which is incredibly awesome product, but it's not really valuable. It wasn't really valuable for the Google, and it wasn't really valuable for the market, and this is why it failed. I suppose it failed because of that, but maybe I don't know it, something. So basically, what is valuable product? In terms of our clients, or product owners, or the guys who own the business and create business rules, valuable product is something that popular, useful, and profitable as a consequence. And so, the biggest question is how to bring value into client product if we're talking about business value. Especially when client doesn't know that he needs business value, because let's face it, most of the clients when they go to us, and I'm not talking only about you know, web agencies, even when we're talking about startups, we have client, the guy who knows what he wants, and the development team. And so there are cases, and there's a lot of them, when client goes to the development team and says, I want this feature, and the reason why he wants it is just, you know, because he wants it. He doesn't put an enormous thought around this feature. So basically, how to bring values into those features, even if client doesn't know that he wants it? Simply by asking why. And why is a very important question, because when you think about client interactions or future of the product, more important is how it will be used than how it's written, really. And this is why is important. So for example, if client comes to you and says that he wants some internalization on the site, ask him why. If client wants some authorization mechanism on the site, ask him why he wants this authorization mechanism. Or maybe client just dreamed of some amazing features for your site, and he went to you saying, oh, I want this feature for the site. Well, you know what to do. You know, ask him why. And this is the biggest part of communication between the client and your development team. But how actually does it help? Because it helps, because correct answers to why helps you to bring higher priority on things that really matter in your product, instead of prioritizing based on the technical complexity or other things that doesn't matter for the value of the product, for the resulting value of the product. And so, if we need this why, we need to expect some answer from the client or product owner. So how does correct why answer looks like? Not really that way, but correct why answer always share two requirements. First, it should answer the added value of the feature, and second, it should point beneficiary of the feature. So the guy who gets this value in case of feature will be implemented or uses their story will be implemented. But for example, let's imagine that client goes to us with simple feature. He wants some sort of ordering mechanism of the users, where user can be sorted in the list. So we can split it into three simple, as simple as possible states, like in order to see top users, as a visitor, I need to be able to sort them by rating. And if you take a closer look, you will see that to see top users is really a value of this feature. And a visitor is a beneficiary. And your feature actually is just need to sort them by rating. But if you add another feature and another feature, you will see that this simple rule applicable to almost any task out there, and you can apply it to any user story, any feature of your project with these rules. And really, it's as simple as heart of BDD. It's really heart of BDD. This simple, in order to, as I need. And X here is a benefit, as you've seen. Y is a person, and Z is, that is some feature. And Don North is an inventor of BDD methodology, and this is his quote about this narrative, this stuff called narrative. So really, it's really heart of your feature, because it brings value into your purely technical stuff. And why do we need this beneficiary and values? Because thanks to them, we can now order or prioritize our features based on the real values of the product and the resulting product. So, for example, we don't talk about technical implementation or technical stuff at this point yet, but we already know that some of the features will be more interesting to our to client users and will be more valuable for the product as a result. So this simple narrative. If you have seen a lot of features or user stories, it might look like user story for you. Well, because it is actually it is a user story that you can that you write in your Scrum methodologies or Kanban or anything else. And this simple narrative helps you to describe it. What we are missing really is how to accept this feature, how to know that this feature is really done by placing the scenarios, some sort of description of what user wants to see from this feature at the end. And we can have multiple of them, and every scenario is split into divided sections, every which of them. Of them have a given, when, and then. Given specifies some initial context, some initial state of the system in which you're starting to describe some functionality. Quen describes some events that you do on the system in order to then test outcomes. So then ensures that you, not really ensures, but describes outcomes after you've made some event or action on the system. And this is another quote from Dan North, inventor of BDD. A story's behavior is simply its acceptance criteria. If system if the system fulfills all the acceptance criteria, it's behaving correctly. If it doesn't, it isn't. So it leads us to next conclusion that acceptance criteria could be automated. And basically, there's where Cucumber and other tools derived from it come into play. There is a lot of them for almost any language out there. For example, there is a Lintage for Python, there is a Cucumber for Ruby, there is a SpecFlow for .NET, and I've created Behalf for PHP. So what basically it does, it splits all this feature file, this purely human-readable description, into some sort of tree, node tree, if you are familiar with parser methodology. So it splits feature into separate scenarios. This feature has two of them. And every scenario is split into specific simple steps. Then what Big Hat, Cucumber, and other frameworks do, other automation tools do, they run every step inside scenario against some specific code that tells system or tool that this code is executed or not. For example, in PHP 1, it looks like this. In Cucumber, it looks something familiar. So basically, you write regular expression that is matched against actual step. For example, we have a step given, I have a bank account, and what we do, we create a bank account instance. Then we have a step when I deposit some money, we deposit this in the code. And so most interesting is that step, which tests the outcomes. And if outcomes are different from what we expected, it throws simple language exception. And then you see that your outcomes are different from what you expected or described in your feature. So this is how it looks like together. And basically, this is what you do when you're doing BDD with some tool. You're describing domain logic, domain model, into simple dictionary that you can use after that to automate testing of your features, of your user stories. And it's basically testing your user stories and not really acceptance testing. Well, it adds acceptance testing, automated acceptance testing to your features, but your features is something that should be readable but not technical persons. And you start from them. So for example, user logins feature. In order to have extended abilities as a site user, I need to be able to log in. So we have one scenario for existing user can log in, and another scenario for non-existing user can log in. And scenarios might look like this. First scenario describes logs in of the existing user, and second describes the failing of login if you're not existing in the database. And and Cucumber or Behat or any other tool gives you ability to some sort of enhance those scenarios, make them reusable and more readable by moving common steps into backgrounds and even using some sort of tables, which is still readable, but more reusable and more clean from the developer point of view and stakeholder or product owner point of view. And also, you can use usual keywords this scenario applying. Every keyboard, this scenario will be run two times. And all placeholders like username, password, message room will be replaced with appropriate values from the table, from each row of the table. So basically, this all is really great, but you still need to write all this. When I feel it, I'm on the page and I press login. And in this case, we're talking about web page, you know, and we're talking about describing a web user interface and how to actually test it. Because really testing of web interfaces are hard task, because you need to emulate at least three things at a time. You need to emulate user, which does some things on the browser. Then you need to emulate the browser, which after user interaction sends something to the server. And then you need to emulate the server and check the outcomes that users see is what you expected. And it's really hard hard task, because there is plenty of tools for testing, like Sahi, Selenium, PhantomJS. There's a lot of tools which does one simple thing, and they emulate interaction of the user on the web page. And I have a tool which does all this with different frameworks for one single API. This thing is called Beam, another framework that I developed. And so basically what Beam does, it removes all the differences across all the frameworks. Like there is a JavaScript framework like Selenium, and there is a pure server-side frameworks like I don't know, which just sends a pure request to the server and gets a pure responses from them. And yeah, that's basically it. And Beam removes all the differences between them, so you can write one single scenario in pure PHP and it will be executed across any browser, any framework like Selenium or Sahi that you configure. And also, Beam comes with default definitions. So for example, there is already available, even I am on the page step, when I fill in some username with some password step. And also there is plenty of steps, like 80 available, and you can use them. And the cool point is, for example, there is some scenarios in which you want to test your page, your web pages against JavaScript. And in these cases, you can just add tag, and this scenario will be run against real web browser. So that's basically it. And that's all for introduction. So if you have something that you want to listen, to talk about, I want to hear real action and questions, because really it's a complex step, and maybe you want something different from what I want to talk about. Anything? Anyone?
That's good. Well, the question is like this. Suppose you have a huge application already, call it Linux application, but you have no how do you start? Is this the right point to start with the native testing or not? So, anything about it?
Yeah, good question, thanks. Basically, what this tool does, what then adds to your stack, your development stack, is ability to actually run your user stories or scenarios, user scenarios that you already have if you're doing Agile. But it adds possibility to automate test of them. For example, if before you have a some user story and you have a tester or client who checks that your user story is actually implemented by you, now you have this thing automated fully. And you can run it on the server side and check that your features that client is requested are actually implemented. And you can do it on any stage of the development process. It's like, in most cases, we're talking about black box testing. When we have application and we're changing some inputs on this application and we're getting some outputs. And we're checking that outputs is something that we expect it to render. And basically, in this case, when we're talking about black box, and in most cases we do, we can integrate this tool on any stage of development without putting real efforts into integrating it into existing development stack. So basically, what you only need to do is to put effort into writing features or scenarios. And in our company, we have experience of even this task, you know, writing features, describing the scenarios to the clients. And it's some, you know, new experience when clients describe some functionality for you. And then you always know that functionalities that you're doing that implemented, if it's green, if it's prompt against your test suite and it's passed, then you always know that this is exactly what clients want, because this is exactly what client described.
Is there any cons is there any negative sides of BDD?
Negative?
Yes.
Yeah, of course. Basically, I've talked only about one side of BDD, which is scenario or story-oriented BDD. There's also different side of BDD. There is a specification of BDD, which looks, which created for developers only, and resolves developers' problems. And it looks like unit testing, you know, in old school. And so here comes the problem of BDD. You know, everybody talks about BDD nowadays, but nobody, you know, talks about different styles and where to use scenario BDD, where to use features, and where to use, you know, old school unit testing, or where to use specificational testing. So the problem is users or developers or companies trying to use this thing as a unit testing tool, you know, to test inner implementation or deep part of their application. And this is because it becomes a problem really fast, because dictionary, those, you know, step definitions, they really make sense when they're really simple and when there's not a lot of them. But if you're talking about unit testing, you're finishing, you know, implementing new language in these terms, in this given one then. And yeah, I've seen a lot of people, you know, facing this problem when they're starting to use it wrongly. Yeah, this is the biggest problem, I think. The second problem is even the companies that understand differences between, you know, features and unit testing, internal implementation testing, they put too many implementation details into features. For example, if you're talking about web page, you can say, you know, for example, this is a bad example, and I am on the login, you know, this slash login is in the pass, you know, pass to some page on the web server. And in most cases, it doesn't tell anything useful about the user interface or the expectations of the stakeholder. But what it does, it tells, you know, some implementation details which should be hidden instead. So for example, instead of I'm on the slash login, I should say I'm on login page. And it's something that even I forget sometimes, you know. And in complex cases, where Mint provides other, you know, Mint is a framework for doing all this stuff and, under the hood, provides some predefined steps. User finish writing writing steps like, then I should see something with CSS selector or XPath selector, which is even worse implementation detail. And you know, you wouldn't be able to show this feature to your stakeholder or product owner because it's purely implementational. And even if he had accepted this, you couldn't be sure that he will accept the final product because it's not what he wants. CSS selectors or implementation details. He wants functionality, you know, and you should describe it in simplest possible, you know, purely human language to be understandable.
Then one more question.
Yeah.
And then in that case, how many scenarios do you think normally? What's your recommendation? How many scenarios must be in this feature? Because feature is user story, and user story not as epic. They are not so large. So I can assume that it's a standard, maybe.
Yeah, basically, when you get more than, I don't know, 7-8 scenarios in the feature, then it means that your feature becomes epic and you need to split it into smaller user stories. And basically, it where to put your new scenario is the best. For example, if you describe some user management, then you can put, you know, user creation, user editing, user deletion in one simple feature, if it's simple. But for example, there could be cases where, for example, activation of the user, which is complex task, which involves, you know, sending emails, activating the user through email link. You can put it into a different feature because it's getting more complex than just simple use case of one feature. So it's more a question of whether it's a already existing feature and you need to add scenario to it, or it's a basically fully new feature that you want to implement. And you need to describe. And yeah, in most cases, you start from the narrative and the feature name. And then when you start to describe it into small scenarios, you start with a scenario and the title of the scenarios. And when you see that feature becomes too deep, you split it into smaller features. And it also helps you because you see the complexity of the feature even before it's starting to describe actual scenarios. And yeah.
So I have two questions. One is about presenting these features to your customer. So now it's like a login script, a login form, and you have two scenarios and it's quite big already. What you will do for your call application, how do you present these scenarios to your customer? Is there any...
What do you mean by present? You mean present the already done implementation or present...
Some results of these.
Result. So basically, this is a description and it shouldn't become too big. If your scenario becomes, I don't know, 15 steps, then you're doing something wrong. For example, there is a cases where you want to describe some functionality for authorized user. So what you can do, you can start from, given I'm on the login page and I'm entering my password, I enter my username and I log in, and this is only to state that you're logged in. And this is not something that interests stakeholder. He already said that this feature should be only for logged in. So you squish this step into a smaller one where you just state that I'm logged in. And you're presenting actually, you're presenting to the client, not user stories or features, you're presenting implementation. So client will always see the side, you know? He will not evaluate you against the features, but you can always show him that his expectations, initial expectations that he stated, are fully passed against your implementation. So for example, he will see the site, he will do same, you know, same flow, same scenario, but in actual browser. He will say, oh, but I want the button between these two states. And you will say, no, it's not what you've expected before. You've changed it legitimately. And the system just tells you that, you know, no, you've done it. Your steps are passing. It means that your implementation is actually what described, what were being described at the beginning.
So then, this leads to the next question. So, why then we need to write this language? So, meta language that instead of this we use programming.
It's to simplify communication with clients before the development process started. Basically, and previous presenters showed this problem, there is a problem of development circles, where before you, on the first you get the feature, you know, some user stories that you need to develop. And you're as a developer split it into the scenarios, you know, small scenarios. And you're doing it by implementing those scenarios. And at the end, you're showing it to the customer. But amount of time between those, you know, actions is enormous in case of development. For example, you can spend two iterations, you know, between getting the user story from the client, implementing it to show it. And on this stage, user stakeholder can say to you, no, it's not what I wanted. And in order to get from him what he wants at the beginning, you need to talk about with him about the scenarios. And you do this already, you know, like, okay, you want this registration form to be, you know, with these fields. And you describe the same thing, but with human language. What you do with this is just dump them into one feature file, and then you just describe it once, with, you know, how to test it in code, and run it during the development. And during you run it, you always see that this feature is fails, this feature is passing, and at the end you get, you know, this is what we've talked with the client about. This is the feature that he wants to see, and this is what we get. Answers your question, no?
Okay, and then...
yeah, maybe you should...
Okay, then next would be that if we split this functionality so small scenarios, then we'll get, at some point, we'll get some small pieces that will not give you the feeling of the application itself. So you will not get a scenario that as a user I can complete the full process in the application. So from the login, work, and logout, something, all the process.
You should, so you know, it's like talking about different features of your application, and you. If you need authentication, you know, login on your application in 90% of cases, you describe this feature authorization first, and you describe it into, you know, self-contained feature like I'm on main page, I click login, I fill in username and password, and if I'm in the site, if I'm registered, I can log in. And then on other features, you just can assume that you're logged in because you already described it. Into scenario, and you can just say when I logged in. But this feature is just described in some different state, and it's already, you know, it runs, and you can show this on any stage of development to your client. You know, like, okay, I'm logged in, and feature for logging in is here. We've developed it first.
But
Okay, then let's put it in a different way. Do you write scenarios which is like a process already? So that assume that all the small things are running and you just follow like a critical path in your application. So do you write these kind of scenarios?
Good question. Basically, we don't cover everything, you know, every part of functionality. What we're doing in our company, we're covering edge cases. You know? For example, if we have complex form and you know, we have a validation on the form, what client says to us on the plain inside is just something like, I want this form to be validated. And this is what we describe, you know, we describe one simple case where we check that validation is already existing. And if we really want to test different types of, you know, different edge cases, smaller cases, we need to use, you know, more obvious tool for them, like unit testing or exception testing. You shouldn't try to cover all the, you know, all the cases, because you will finish with huge, enormously huge feature files, which doesn't describe any, you know, business value about your feature. Instead, you should use proper tools for that. But you should cover the edge cases which are important for the business. Anyone else?
So, I write that BDD can be fully separated from testing and development.
The question was, could BDD be separated from the test drive development? And yes, and in most cases it should be separated. So basically you end with you know, with a couple of circles of development. You start with getting user story from the client, and then you communicate with client in order to write those features, you know, set those features. And then you start implementing. And in order to implement, you write, you know, unit testing, test-driven development to just ensure that your internal implementation of the application is correct. Because, you know, if your application at some state from the outside behaves correctly, it doesn't, you know, gives you proof that it's implemented correctly inside, internally, and that architecture is really good to extend, to be extendable at the end. So this is something that TDD or, you know, specification of BDD should solve. And yeah, you should use both in the best case. But there are some cases where behavior of the application is more important than, you know, than how it's implemented. For small amount of projects, you know, when you know that there will be no support for them, you know, like the project will die here, and you know, something like that. In these cases, you can, you know, stop with just features and describing how the application is behaving out from outside and testing that with some tool like the Grammar or BDD. But in most cases, if you're talking about, you know, long-term product, you should use both, because if your product behaves from the outside correctly, it doesn't prove that it's written internally correctly, and it could be extended in some ways